Good evening. Good to see each one of you here tonight. Let's stand together for our first hymn. This is a great hymn. This is one that makes you want to march around the church. So if you can't help it, if the Lord's in it, you go ahead and do that. But if not, just sing out the banner of the cross.
There's a royal banner given for display to the soldiers of the King. As an ensign fair we lift it up today, while as ransomed ones we sing. Marching on, marching on, for Christ count everything but loss, and to crown Him King, toil and sing, neath the banner of the cross. Though the foe may rage and gather as the flood, let the standard be displayed, and beneath its folds as soldiers of the Lord, for the truth be not dismayed. Marching on, marching on, for Christ count everything but loss, and to crown Him King, toil and sing, neath the banner of the cross. Over land and sea, wherever man may dwell, make the glorious tidings known of the crimson banner. Now the story tell, while the Lord shall claim His own. Marching on, marching on, for Christ count everything but loss, and to crown Him King, toil and sing, neath the banner of the cross.
Amen. You may be seated.
All right. Well, good evening and welcome out to Grace Baptist Church. I hope that you are praying for our Awana program and all that's going on next door as we meet here together tonight. Just a few announcements that we have coming up. Obviously, this week is our ladies' banquet, and that is this coming Saturday. And so if you could please sign up today, that will give us a great count for that, and that's a wonderful blessing to the ladies in our church, and as you invite people from our community to come out, I know it'll be a blessing to them as well. Miss Hannah Sire will be our speaker this year, and Brother Tucker and I have a great meal prepared for you, and that's always just a wonderful time together. The next Sunday is our baby dedication coming up, and we have several babies that have been born over this last year, and I'm kind of excited about this week and looking forward to just the number of families up here together celebrating and really dedicating their children back to the Lord. It's really exciting. You know, sometimes, you know, babies, you know, crying can get on your nerves. And if you're a parent, you're thinking all the time, right? And but man, when they're in church and you hear just the babies crying and kids making noise, it just shows the vibrancy of the church and just the joy, and praise the Lord for that. A couple of ministry opportunities that I want to point out. First of all, Miss Kay down here, we'll call her the purple lady, and she has the purple hair. She's involved in two ministries this week. One of them is weekly. On Mondays, she meets with a group of believers in front of the police station at 8 a.m. each Monday, and they pray for the police station. They just take a few moments, take some prayer requests, and pray together. And you can do that if you have time before you're going to work or going to work out or before you go back home and go back to bed, whatever you're doing on a Monday morning. And they meet there. And then on Tuesday night, she is a part of an organization and helps sponsor children in India and some different ministry opportunities there. And this Tuesday night, they're having a banquet at the Anderson Country Club. And if you'd be interested in that, the meal is free and you can go as her guest. You can see her here tonight, and I know she would love to have you with her and then give you information about that. And then coming up on May the 21st is the First Choice Walk for Life. This helps us raise funds for the First Choice for Women ministry, and we've been a part of this ministry for about 4 years now, and we sponsor them in many different things throughout the year. And we want to encourage you to, first of all, register as a participant to come out that day and be a part of that. You can come out to walk or you can come out to work. And so they need people that give, pass out water and just help in many different areas there that day. And if you want to help in either of those two ways, you can see Brother Will and he can get you the information that you need there. And then you could also participate in, by not only showing up, but by giving. And so every year that we've been a part of this, we have either won, this is kind of prideful, I understand this, but we have either won the most walkers or helpers, which we like to do, or the most funds raised. So we should do both this year, all right? And so you come out, be a part of that, you participate in that, and I know it'll be a great blessing to the folks that serve in this ministry. We have multiple people in our church that work in this ministry on a weekly basis throughout the year, and if that's something you're interested in doing, you can see Brother Will, and he can get you that information as well. Coming up, it's hard to believe, school's almost out, so with that, our Awana Grand Prix is coming up on May the 15th, that's 2 weeks from today, from 5 to 7 that Sunday night. It'll be our whole service. We do this together as a church. The kids are in Awana working on their derby cars, and this has been a great time for us as a church together, and it's been a little while since we've done it as a church because of COVID and things like that, but we'll be all back together for that event, and we're looking forward to that on May the 15th. And then on June the 5th is our graduation Sunday, and if you have a high school graduate or a college graduate, if you can let the office know, we would like to recognize them that day and have a gift for them as well. Well, that's our announcements, and hopefully if you did not catch all that, there are some bulletins out, and we always have this in the email. How many of you open up your email every week from Nicole? All right, go ahead and raise your hand up. All right, if you did not, you should open your email every week because you're the person that's going to say, I don't know anything about that. And or I didn't hear an announcement about that. And we send out emails on a regular basis about those things. You know, the funny thing is about those email chains, the thing they use, they can tell who opened them. So I open it every day. I might not read it, but I open it so Will doesn't come and say, you didn't open my email. So open those up. Make sure you read them. Make sure you print out your announcements. You know what's going on. Put it on your calendar and all that type of stuff. And then along those lines, we are redeveloping, I guess I could say, our church app. And that's kind of been put on the back burner. Some of the technology that we were using has gone by the wayside. And so Brother Luttrell has been working with a new company, and we'll be getting that information out to you soon. But that is another way to keep up there and then also on our website as well. It's been a joy to be with the Lambs. You know, they have been close to our family. Brother Lamb went to the Christian school that my parents ran in Tuscaloosa, Alabama, when you were 15. When he was 15 years old, and through that ministry, he trusted Christ as his Savior. And so our families have been close for many years. And then when I was getting ready to be in my senior year of college, he talked with me about coming on staff with him. And so I was able to serve at Glen Iris Baptist Church, where he serves as the pastor for a few years there, and had the opportunity to coach basketball, and his son was a junior and senior my 2 years there, and coaching, and we just had a great team and a great time together, and the Lord gave us a wonderful group of kids there in that ministry. I had the opportunity to teach in the school, and I learned in that ministry, I tell people all the time when I share my testimony, God put me in certain jobs to show me that this is not what I have for you to do. All right. I was a Christian school teacher, and I realized this is not what I was supposed to do. I was a school administrator, not only just a teacher. Then I went to be a school administrator, and I learned this is not what you're supposed to do. I was a youth pastor, and I learned this is not what you're supposed to do. I was a college president, and I realized, yeah, this is not what you're supposed to do. So this is the last job I have on the list, people. Like, so you are stuck. There is no other jobs for me out there. So this is what I've trained for. This is all I know how to do now. And really, I don't even know if I'm qualified for this one yet. But this is it. So we're here, and we praise the Lord for that. But I appreciate Pastor Lamb and others that have given me those opportunities to help me and have invested in my life. And him and his wife, Kathy, and their two children have been so close to us, and we appreciate them very much. After we finish our singing together and have our special, Pastor Lamb's going to bring our message tonight, but let's pray together. Father, we do thank you for, Lord, our church and, Lord, all that's going on, and we just thank you for the life that's in our ministry and, Lord, just the working of the Holy Spirit. I thank you for, Lord, those that came today that want to be baptized and, Lord, those that came that want to join the church. And, Lord, it's just such a blessing to see the new folks that you're bringing in and that are excited, Lord, about serving you and being a part of this local body. And Father, I pray that we won't take that for granted, but we faithfully minister and help them and also continue to reach out in our community. I thank you for the upcoming opportunities that were even mentioned. And I pray that as a church, Lord, we get behind these opportunities to be able to reach folks with the gospel of Christ. And Lord, we pray tonight that you would be honored and glorified as we sing, as Sydney plays, and Lord, use your message tonight in our hearts and lives. And we thank you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Let's sing together, Trust and Obey.
When we walk with the Lord in the light of His Word, what a glory He sheds on our way. While we do His good will, He abides with us still, and with all who will trust and obey. And obey, for there's no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey. Not a burden we bear, not a sorrow we share, but our toil and obey. Trust and obey, for there's no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey. Then in fellowship sweet we will sit at His feet,
that's good singing. Let's stand tonight as we sing our final hymn, Be Strong in the Lord.
Be strong in the Lord and be of good courage, your mighty defender. Christ, for the victory is yours. Be strong in the Lord and be of good courage. Your mighty commander will vanquish the foe. Fear not the battle, for the victory is always his. He will protect you wherever you go. Be strong in the Lord and be of good courage, for he is your guide. Be strong in the Lord and rejoice, for the victory is yours.
Amen. You may be seated.
Well, thank you, Sydney. What a beautiful song. Thank you for all the kind words, Brother Stevens. I feel like the missionary, Hudson Taylor, he was being introduced to this large missionary conference, and they said all kinds of things about him. And he got up and he said, "Lord, forgive them for what they said, and forgive me for enjoying it so much." So, kind of feel like the lady, the widow, she was at her husband's funeral, and he had not been what he should have been. But the preacher was doing it. I mean, he was just laying it on thick and heavy, preaching him into heaven. And finally, somewhere along the way, she tapped her son on the head and said, "Son, go look in the casket and see if that's your dad. I think they've got the wrong person." It's always an honor when a pastor invites you to preach in his pulpit. I mean, this is a sacred responsibility. It is his job not only to teach you the Word of God, but to fence the pulpit, you know, to be careful about what goes forth from this place. And it's always an honor after, you know, having served on a staff, for him still to want me to come and preach. That's amazing, isn't it? But I appreciate that so much. This is a vibrant church, alive, and you folks have been so gracious, and I just sense the Lord is doing a great work here, and we're thrilled for you. We love your pastor and his family. I know you know that they're the real deal, and you're very fortunate to have these folks here serving among you, and I thank you for your kindness to them, and you're following the leadership here. 1 Samuel chapter 30, if you'll turn there with me. 1 Samuel chapter 30. We'll begin there in verse 1. 1 Samuel chapter 30 and verse 1. And it came to pass when David and his men were come to Ziklag on the third day that the Amalekites had invaded the south, and Ziklag had smitten Ziklag and had burned it with fire. And had taken the women captives that were therein. They slew not any, but neither great or small, not either the late women or the small ones, but they carried them away, and they went on their way. So David and his men came to the city, and behold, it was burned with fire, and the wives and their sons and their daughters were taken captives. Then David and the people that were with him lifted up their voice and wept until they had no more power to weep. You can imagine the scene. What a horrible scene this was. Nothing left but ashes. They had no idea that anyone would be left alive, and for all they knew, they were not. Verse 6, David was greatly distressed. Of course he was. When you find out what they were about to do, his men spake of stoning him, because the soul of all the people was grieved, every man for his sons and his daughters. But David encouraged himself in the Lord his God. The Amalekites were ancient enemies of the Lord and his people. You'll recall that in Exodus chapter 17, when the children of Israel first left Egypt, Aaron and Hur held up Moses' arms as they fought against the Amalekites. They came against them right off the bat. And when the victory was finally realized, God told Moses, "Write this for a memorial. Rehearse it in the ears of Joshua. I will utterly destroy the remembrance of Amalek from under heaven." You'll remember that King Saul was given that task as well, and he did not fully obey the Lord. And they survived and continued to attack God's people. Saul's obedience was no obedience at all, was it? It was an incomplete obedience, and incomplete obedience today always leads the way for future failure. David here is in exile. He's running from King Saul. The wrath, the jealousy, the paranoia, whatever you want to call it, of Saul. And he has hidden himself among the Lord's enemies, the Philistines, reasoning that Saul would not venture to find him there. David had no business living among the Philistines. You'll know in the Bible there are two great types of the world, Egypt and the Philistines. They're always types of worldliness and the enemies of God. David and his men who went with him had no business being there. The Philistines didn't trust him. They always wondered about him. He at one time pretended to be insane. Can you picture that picture of David with his spittle drooling down his beard, all just trying to play the part? The true child of God makes for a miserable worldling, caught between two worlds and belonging in one but not the other. The Bible tells us a double-minded man is unstable in all of his ways, and David is surely picturing that here during his exile. Achish, king of Gath, gave David the village of Ziklag for an outpost, an operating place. They would camp out there. They lived there while they were in exile. And from time to time, he and his men would venture out from their home base and go out and attack, do some marauding against the Amalekites, and they'd come back. And while David and his men were attempting to fight alongside the Philistines against the Israelites. Now, can you picture this? The future king of Israel has aligned with the Philistines to fight against his own people, the Israelites. While they were doing that, the Amalekites seized the opportunity to raid and ransack Ziklag, and kidnapping the women and the children, burning everything to ashes. The Bible says they carried them away there in verse 2, and that word means literally that they drove them like cattle. Can you see the picture? The women and the children being driven like that from Ziklag into captivity. David and his mighty men came home to this horrible scene. The Bible says in verse 4, they lifted up their voices and weeping until they had no more power to weep. David has some important lessons to learn. He will be the future king of Israel, but not even the king of Israel, already anointed for that office, can sin and get by with it. And he must be taught some lessons. Hebrews 12, verse 5 says, "Despise not the chastening of the Lord, nor faint when thou art rebuked of him. For whom the Lord loveth, he chasteneth, and scourgeth every son whom he receiveth." The future king of Israel is not exempt from the spiritual law of the kingdom of God. The Lord's kingdom is ruled by spiritual laws just as real, just as standing as the physical laws of the universe. We're bound by them, aren't we? The law of gravity. You know, if I drop my Bible, it will fall to the floor. You don't have to wonder about that. That's a law. It will always take place. The spiritual laws are just as standing. They're just as real. And so we're not exempt from reaping what we sow. In verse 6, we read, "David was greatly distressed, for the people spake of stoning him. Because the soul of all the people was grieved, every man for his sons and his daughters." The enemy had come against David, and the Bible tells us that we will reap what we sow. David had clearly violated the teaching of Psalm 1. The man of God should not walk in the counsel of the ungodly, nor stand in the way of sinners, nor camp out, nor sit in the seat of the scornful. While King Achish had a soft spot in his heart for David and even allowed him to go along with him on this particular skirmish against the Israelites, the other leadership of the Philistines didn't trust David. They couldn't reconcile in their minds why David and his men, who were Israelites, really fighting against the Israelites. It didn't make sense. And, you know, the world knows when we're out of place. The world knows that you profess to know the Lord, and when we don't act in accordance to that, they distrust that. And reluctantly, Achish released them and said, you don't have to join with us in this battle. Sometimes God turns people against us because he's working for us. And he's doing that to get us back where we need to be. When David and his men see the smoldering ruins of Ziklag, their hearts melt within them, and we can only imagine the grief and the horror of what they saw and what they felt. When we step out of God's will for us, we expose ourselves to the enemies of God. Jonah had to learn that, didn't he? We see it throughout the Scripture. And we take ourselves out of that promised protection of God to some degree. Now, the child of God is always there in God's hands, but when we step out of his will, we expose ourselves in a way that he has not designed for us. And this was David's first experience. It will not be his last, but it is his first experience of the chastening hand of the Lord. Until now, he had been guided and kept and guarded even in exile. He didn't have to go to this extent. He didn't even have to leave Israel, did he? He hadn't been killed yet, had he? Had he been harmed in any way? Though in danger and fearful situations, the Lord had always sustained him and protected him by the providing hand of God and the providence of God. Now he felt the sting from God's disciplining hand. And David was greatly distressed. I think that David knew this was a reckoning. When he came on the horizon and saw the smoke rising from Ziklag and what was the obvious scene there, I think he knew in his heart the why behind it. Now, one thing you'll find at a time like this that, and Job found this out, did he not, that people around you are always ready to assign blame, especially when they think you're at fault. Had they not left Israel with him and followed him? Had they not joined the Philistines as he did? Had he not provoked the Amalekites? On and on the questions could arise. Please note where you keep your important messages. God is always in control of every situation, even when he is chastening his children. But when God has a way of knocking all the props out from under us, things that we're leaning on instead of him, instead of his word, instead of his promises, instead of his will, and trusting him with all of our hearts and leaning not on our own understanding. You see, David had gotten here by faulty reasoning. We'll see that in just a moment. But God has to correct that false thinking, that the mindset, casting down imaginations and every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of God, and bringing into captivity every thought, the Bible tells us, to the obedience of Christ. When we stop thinking biblically, we begin thinking worldly and making worldly decisions. And God knows when we're making little idols out of things that usurp his exclusive place. David is eating the bitter fruit of his own willfulness and stubbornness. David must be, as Peter tells us, humble himself under the mighty hand of God, and then he will lift you up. When this kind of disappointment comes, when this kind of situation comes, as it did to David, we should examine it. We may not always be able, Job never did, because this was a different situation, but we ought to examine the situation and find out what God is teaching us, what is behind it. God is always getting our attention, nothing else, just as drawing us closer to himself and causing us to trust him implicitly and above even our own feelings and desires. He knows exactly how to get our attention, doesn't he? I would venture to say, if we were to give testimony tonight, every one of you could tell me that God has had to get your attention at some point using various means to do so. It may be he's trying to get us away from something or someone or somewhere, guiding us back to where we should be. What a dark day. David's closest associates are now contemplating stoning him. Israel's already anointed and future looks anything but like a king at this point. Under the Holy Spirit's inspiration, David will write, "Search me, O God, and know my heart. Try me and know my thoughts. See if there's a wicked way in me, and lead me in the way of everlasting." It's always important to learn from these biographical accounts. The Lord is, whatsoever things were written aforetime are written for our learning. So these biographies are not just history lessons. The reason the Holy Spirit goes to great detail to tell us about this particular time in David's life is so that we can learn from it. We can use it as a pattern, or as the Bible says, an example, in samples. These are in samples to us. And so I want us to look. We've seen the background there. What did David do in this time of great distress? What are we to do at such a time? We looked there in the last part of verse 6, but David encouraged himself in the Lord his God. King Saul is trying to kill him. The Amalekites are trying to annihilate him. The Philistines are a snare to him. These represent our three great enemies: the world, the Philistines, the flesh, the Amalekites, the devil, Saul himself. We have three great enemies, ever, always present, never leave us all the way through this pilgrimage journey. What did David do? He encouraged himself in the Lord his God. Now, granted, most people are waiting for others to encourage them. But as mature believers, as Christian workers, as evangelists and missionaries and pastors and teachers and laymen, all the rest, we must learn to do what David did here, to encourage ourselves in the Lord our God. By the way, we're to all be encouragers. That doesn't let anybody off the hook. This faith family here, one of the major parts of our ministry, your ministry here is to encourage one another, seeking to be a blessing and to help others, and just always asking, Lord, how can I do that? When you hear a need called out from the pulpit or you see it in the prayer bulletin, Lord, how could I be a part of being a blessing to that person or answering that prayer request? It never should be if, but how, Lord, should I be? It may be sending a card or a call or a text or whatever, or taking a pie or a casserole or whatever it may be. It may be in a tangible way. Whatever it may be, but we ought to pray, Lord, how can I be an encouragement to this particular situation? That's one of the reasons when we meet together, we're not to forsake the assembling of ourselves together, but part of that, it goes on to say, exhorting, encouraging one another, admonishing. All of that is part of the Christian ministry and our duties as fellow believers in this assembly of believers. The word here has the connotation, when it says David encouraged himself in the Lord, it has the connotation of strengthening, of curing even, of giving a medicinal, a spiritual medicine to the inner man. The outer man is perishing, but the inner man is growing day by day. And we minister and make tend to the outer man, I'm afraid, far more than we do the inner man, which is more important, the spiritual above the physical. We live in a body. They both are important. But the inner man, I fear, is often neglected. Curing the inner man. How did he do that? Strengthening, curing, helping, repairing, fortifying, recovering. That has all of that connotation in that word. David encouraged himself in the Lord his God. This is the work of the ministry. And many times we'll have to learn to minister to our own selves in this way. David's true spirituality had been eclipsed by some wrong decisions, and that's often the case in a believer's life. Wrong reasonings. You've seen it. You've had a fellow believer, and you say, they're just not thinking right. Why did they make that stupid decision? We've seen it, haven't we? We've seen it in our own lives. Why did I do that? 1 Samuel chapter 27, verse 1, back there, David said in his heart, I shall now perish one day at the hand of Saul. Is that a truth or a lie? That's a lie, isn't it? Do you see that David began to receive one of the fiery darts of the wicked, and he took it to heart, and he said, yeah, I'm going to die here in exile. I'll never sit on the throne. This has got to stop. And he said, I shall now perish one day at the hand of Saul. That's wrong thinking. There's nothing better for me than I should speedily escape into the land of the Philistines. He developed a plan. A wrong thinking will bring about a wrong game plan, won't it? I'm going to die, so I need to go protect myself by hiding in exile among the Philistines. And Saul shall despair of me. In other words, he'll give up looking for me there. And to seek me anymore in any coast of Israel, I won't be in Israel. He won't find me in Israel. He'll never think that I would go and live with the Philistines. Of course not. You don't belong there. He'll quit looking for me. So shall I escape out of his hand. Stupid, dumb, sinful reasoning because he believed a lie. All because he received the lie from the wicked one. I shall die at the hands of Saul. It was a lie, wasn't it? A fiery dart from the wicked one. Had he forgotten that the Lord had already sought him out by Samuel? And Samuel had already anointed him king there in the back 40 of his daddy's pasture. Saul couldn't kill David. It was impossible for him to kill David. David is in the sheltering hands of God. Away with the thought. We should always ask ourselves, what lies am I believing? We're not exempt from them, child of God. We have to daily sift through the philosophies of this world, the stuff that comes our way, and we sift it through by the standard of God's Word and say, no, that's not true. I can't live like that. It doesn't matter how factual, how pressing it may be from the world around us. Thus saith the Lord, this is how I will live my life. This is God's will for me. It may go against my flesh. It may go against all the odds. It may look like I'm about to sink. But let me ask you, can the boat sink while God is in it? Remember when the storm came and the Lord was asleep in the bottom of the boat and he said, "Don't you care that we perish?" What a stupid statement. The boat can't sink because God is in the boat with them. We should always ask ourselves, what lies am I entertaining? What wrong thinking is influencing me? Who hath bewitched you? Do you remember that Paul asked the Galatians, who has bewitched you that you should be removed from the faith, removed in your thinking? We should make no provision for the flesh. Can I just remind you that your flesh, the old part of you, your old nature, has not improved one iota since the day you were born. It will never improve. The flesh is susceptible to the lies and the luxuries and the ways of the world. But be renewed in the spirit of your mind, the new man, which is created in righteousness and true holiness. We should make no provision for the flesh, neither give place to the devil, no territory to the devil. David is in the devil's workshop, isn't he? God had told King Saul through Samuel, after Samuel, remember when when King Saul usurped his position, the king had no right to offer sacrifice or burnt offering. And Saul kept waiting for Samuel, and Samuel didn't get there when he wanted him to. He was late in his mind. So he went ahead and offered the burnt offering himself. And back in chapter 13, verse 14 of this chapter, but now Samuel tells Saul, now your kingdom shall not continue. You've just cooked your goose. Your kingdom is going to end with you. Your kingdom will not continue. The Lord hath sought a man after his own heart, and the Lord hath commanded him to be captain over his people because thou hast not kept that which the Lord commanded you or entrusted to you. And David was his replacement. Though it had not actualized yet, child of God, the promises of God and God's plans for you are just as real and complete as if you already were enjoying them. Your glorification, which God has promised, is just as complete as if you were there already standing before Him with a brand new body and a glorified body and mind. The promises of God in Christ Jesus are yea and amen. They cannot be rescinded. How then did David do this? We see what he did. The Bible very plainly tells us, but David encouraged himself. There was nobody to encourage him, was it? Samuel was nowhere around. There was no one to come along and say, well, David, let me show you. Let me pray with you. There was none of that. Those closest to him wanted to kill him. It doesn't get any lonelier than this. How did he do it? It goes without saying that he must have repented of his sin and his worldliness, his wrong thinking, his disobedience, his disloyalty to the people of God. Praise the Lord. If we confess our sins, He's faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. We know this must be the case because the proverb tells us, whoso covereth his sins shall not prosper, but whoso confesseth and forsaketh his sins shall have mercy. So I'm sure that David cried out to the Lord, even though the Holy Spirit does not record that for us. We know that in the ways of God, sin must be dealt with first before anything else can take place. So it's always appropriate to pray, Lord, search me and know my heart and try me and know my thoughts and show me. But beyond that, what did David do to encourage himself in the Lord? Well, we must encourage ourselves, first of all, in the Lord by rejoicing over our present provisions. Well, it doesn't look like David has many provisions on the surface, does it? You may say, what does he have? He didn't have anything. Some might ask, what provisions? The village is burned. The family is kidnapped. His possessions are stolen. He's bankrupt. He didn't even have any friends at this point. Always pause. Child of God, no matter how dark the day, no matter how deep the abyss it seems that you have fallen, always pause and count your blessings. Are we not blessed? Do I need to conjure up the memory tonight? Let me ask you these questions. Was David dead? No. They spake of stoning him, but did they? God's restraining hand kept that from taking place. Wasn't dead. Let me ask us this. Let's do some inventory here. Were any of his mighty men dead? Did any one of those men who went with him lose their lives? Not as far as we know, every one of them was there. In fact, he will soon recover everything that was lost. Now, he doesn't know it right now, but he's going to ask the Lord in just a moment. And verse 18 tells us, and David recovered all that the Amalekites had carried away. In verse 19, there was nothing lacking. Nothing lacking. David recovered all. God's providence and his protection kept the women and children safe. Nothing was done to them harmfully. It's amazing, isn't it? God's protecting hand. Is it not always space to thank God for that things are as well as they are with us right now? Proverbs 21:1, the king's heart is in the Lord's hand as rivers of water. He turneth it with us wherever he will. God had kept providentially his, though they were kidnapped, they were not harmed. Matthew Henry, the great expositor, was mugged and robbed one day. And it was reported after it that he said, I praise God for it. And the people around him said, you know, are you crazy? Why would you? What is there to thank God for in being mugged? He said, well, first of all, I thank God that although he took all my money, it wasn't very much. Secondly, I thank God that while he took my money, which can be replaced, he did not take my life. And thirdly, I thank my God that though I was robbed and beaten, I was the victim and not the perpetrator. I didn't commit the crime, but for the grace of God, I could have been in that place. Thank the Lord tonight that things are as well as they are with us. And so we must first, and always the first order of business, child of God, after we confess sin, and you know there may not be anything to confess, but we can always pause and praise God. What did Job do? Though he slay me, I will serve him. I came into this world without anything. I will leave this world without anything. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Worship, praise is always appropriate. Satan hates it. And it will cure just about whatever ails the inner man. Praise him for present provisions. Or, Brother Lamb, I don't have very much. You have what you have. And God is able to make it like the cruse of oil or the widow's mite. He can make, and the little boy's lunch, he can make little a lot in his own divine providence. We've all seen that, haven't we? Praise the Lord for present provisions. Oh, I could camp out there. I could tell you time and time again, the Lord's gracious provisions to us. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. The Lord daily loadeth us with benefits. We're weighted down with them. Oh, they may not be seen on the bottom line in a spreadsheet. And there may not be anything in the coffers at home, but oh, I'm a child of the King. His royal blood flows through my veins. I can sing. I'm a child of the King. Secondly, David encouraged himself in the Lord by prevailing prayer. To be sure, he had not sought the Lord's will about going to live among the Philistines. If he had, what would he have been told? No, don't go. Sometimes we don't ask the Lord because we don't want to know. Even though we know in our heart, we just don't want to pray about it. And when there's always, someone said every failure can be traced back to a prayer failure. But we know this, that David did not pray about going to live among the Philistines. He had not sought the Lord's will. No more than Abraham did when he went down to Egypt. Remember when the famine came and he went down to Egypt? Abraham didn't pray about that. And we see there in verse 7, David said to Abiathar the priest, Ahimelech's son, I pray thee, bring me hither the ephod. And Abiathar brought thither the ephod to David, and David inquired at the Lord, saying, shall I pursue after this troop? Shall I overtake them? Now, in the Old Testament economy, you know the ephod had the Urim and the Thummim. It had a white stone and a black stone. And God in his providence had designed for that particular dispensation, for them to use that in that way at times to determine his will. We don't determine God's will in that way today. Today we have the indwelling Holy Spirit who will lead us and guide us into all truth. We have the Word of God here before us. We have what David didn't even have the entire Word of God, did he? We have everything that God wants us to know is given to us in this book, and we can go to it for guidance and direction to ascertain God's will for us. No matter what our circumstances are, determining the will of God is always at the first order of business. Where am I supposed to be? What am I supposed to be doing? And then everything else will find its place. Our encouragement, our strength to carry on comes largely from knowing and doing the will of God. We see there in verse 8, he answered him, pursue. Had he only asked the Lord before now, this would never have happened. Shall I go and bring back our families and our stuff? And the Lord said, yes, pursue. For thou shalt surely, he didn't only tell him what to do, he gave him a promise, didn't he? You're going to get everything back that you lost. God didn't have to do that, did he? And he may not always do it in part of his disciplining of us, but in this case, he graciously, he's always so gracious to us, isn't he? He always gives us more than we deserve and more than we need. And not only did he say, go and pursue, but you're going to get everything back, every single thing back. David had no rest, no peace among the Philistines. And no child of God has any business camping out among the world, and you'll never find happiness there. He rejoiced over his present circumstances. He saw that, hey, I'm alive, and he had strength enough to pray. He resorted to prevailing prayer. We can say so much more about that. That is the means that God has given to us to get our needs met. But thirdly, David encouraged himself in the Lord. And though this is implied, there is no encouragement for the child of God apart from God's word. David must have reminded himself of the promises of God. In 1 Samuel 16, I've reminded us that Samuel sought and found David, the youngest son of Jesse, so insignificant in his own father's mind that he didn't bother about telling him that he had to be asked about David. That's pretty much being the lowest on the totem pole. And he was anointed to be king, and the Spirit of the Lord came upon David from that day forward. God has given to us exceeding great and precious promises, people. Hebrews 13:5, for one. I could go down. I'll just give you some of my favorite ones, okay? I will never leave thee nor forsake thee. Oh, what a promise. You can ride through any storm with that promise. I will never, and you know, I'm sure you've been taught in the Greek, it says, I will never, no, never, no, never leave thee nor forsake thee. The Greek specialist can verify that. I'm not sure if I did that exactly right, but I know it's like the in the hymn, How Firm a Foundation. The songwriter gets it right there in his interpretation of that verse. I will never leave thee nor forsake thee. Philippians 1 verse 6, being confident of this very thing, that he that hath which hath begun a good work in you, your salvation, he saved you, he started, he placed his Holy Spirit within you, will perform it how long? Until you blow it? Until you go live among the Philistines? He will perform it until the day of Christ. He which hath begun a good work in you will perform it until the day. He's not through, folks. It doesn't matter how dark it is, how deep the well may be that we find ourselves in, we will be crowned one day. We will wear a crown. We will be transformed. We will reign with our Lord. He's promised, Revelation 20, verse 6, they shall be priests of God and of Christ and shall reign with him 1,000 years. Praise God for his promises. We could go on and on, and I hope you have a supply of them that you lean upon and draw upon and quote and bring them out like the artillery of heaven, the great and exceeding precious promises of God. Praise God for his promises. Martha Snell Nicholson was an invalid most of her life. I'm not sure what her condition was, and I think she lost a child. And anyway, most of her life she was bedridden, but many people would say it was a wasted life. But she left a rich legacy of poetry. You can Google her and find some of the poems. And she wrote this: "One by one he took them from me, all the things I valued most, until I was empty-handed. Every glittering toy was lost. And I walked earth's highways grieving in my rags and poverty, until I heard a voice inviting, 'Lift your empty hands to me.' So I held my hands toward heaven, and he filled them with the store of his own transcendent riches until they could contain no more. And at last I comprehended, with my stupid mind and dull, that God could not pour out his riches into hands already full." David encouraged himself in the Lord his God. Gracious Lord, we thank you for your word. It is our meat, it is our life, it is our sustenance. We pray that we as your sheep would feed upon this food this Lord's Day evening. Speak to our hearts. Lord, show us our sin. Show us yourself. Show us your promises and your blessings. Oh, do a work in our midst. And Lord, we just come as your people and submit and say, Lord, lead me and guide me into all truth. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Pastor Lamb, for that message. You know, no matter where you are in life, you've probably come through some trials, or you're going to go through some trials in life. And a lot of times, especially in the culture that we live in today, we're kind of isolated. You know, we come to church and we have that, but we, you know, leave and go to our homes. And a lot of times we don't see people till Wednesday or maybe the next Sunday or the next activity. And it's and a lot of times, you know, we're maybe, I don't know, shamed, or we hide what's going on or whatever. And so it's very important, though, that number one, I believe God has given us a local church to be an encouragement to one another and to strengthen each other as we go through this life. And Hebrews 10 tells us that we should gather more and more as we see the day approaching because of the persecution and trials. But we have to learn to really find our encouragement in our life from the Lord individually. You know, when we're by ourselves, or, you know, just isolated at times, it can seem, you know, we can find ourselves in despair. And it's so important, you know, and these principles that he laid out tonight are just, I believe, so vital for us to really encourage ourselves and really strengthen ourselves as we go through some of these difficult times. And I think it's important to focus on these even when things seem to be going well. Because sometimes we find ourselves where, you know, we get to where it's like rock bottom and like, okay, what do I do? Where if our normal practice was to go to the Lord in prayer, that's a normal routine. Go to his word, put trust in his promises, make that just a normal daily part of our life. That would be a great help. So when we come to that, it's not something new or something we're trying to figure out, something out of the ordinary to fix this. How often do we do that? We don't rely on God. We don't make the Bible reading a priority, and then we need it. And then all of a sudden, okay, we're there. We're relying on it. We're trusting. We're reading the Bible. Things are good again. Okay, let's go back to the old way of doing things. Really, what he laid out for us really should just be a normal pattern of life. So thank you very much. Tonight, let's go ahead and stand together, and we're going to close our service by singing another verse of "Be Strong in the Lord."
So put on the armor the Lord has provided, and place your defense in his unfailing care. Trust him, for he will be with you in battle, lighting your path to avoid every snare. Be strong, be strong, be strong. strong in the Lord and rejoice, for the victory is yours.
Amen. You are dismissed.